video, we're going to drain down a central heating system, which is connected to a combination boiler. We're also going to add a chemical flush to the system, and after that we are then going to refill and add some inhibitor to the system. If you are not familiar with central heating systems, in the UK and other parts of the world, we use central heating to heat houses and basically keep us warm. Radiators are normally situated in each room. Some rooms might have more than one radiator. The central heating system is completely separate from the potable water system in the property, although both the central heating and domestic hot water are often heated by just one boiler. There are several different systems, and I'm not a plumber, so I'm not going to go into too much detail. But basically, the central heating system is full of water and hopefully some inhibitor to prevent corrosion. The water is heated by the boiler, normally using gas, but heating oil boilers or even electric boilers can be used. But in the UK, the majority of boilers are heated using mains gas. Once the water is heated, it is circulated around the system and the radiators get warm. The heat then radiates out from the radiator and heats the room. This video is going to drain down a combination boiler system, which is a closed system. Conventional systems have a header tank, which constantly keeps the system topped up with water. But if a combination boiler system loses any water, it needs physically topping back up with water. The first thing we need to do is switch the boiler off. This is normally easy and is just a case of pressing a button or flicking a switch. This system uses a wireless thermostat which will call for heat. So I'm switching the thermostat right down so that the boiler will not call for heat as soon as it is switched back on. To avoid any confusion, this is what a digital pressure display looks like. And this is an analog or regular pressure gauge. Draining down a conventional heating system is done in a similar fashion, but you need to isolate the header tank to prevent the system from refilling. Sometimes there is an isolation valve or a gate valve that can be closed, but if not, you can tie the ball float valve up using a piece of wood and a webbing strap or rope to prevent the system from refilling. We now need to find a drain valve. These are normally located on a radiator downstairs, which is often close to the outside of the property. We have attached a standard hose pipe to the drain off and have secured this using a Jubilee clip. The other end of the hose pipe is run to a drain. On top of the valve there is a square. If you open this using a small spanner, the water will start to drain from the system. The water might be clear or it might be discoloured. In order to get the water out from the system, you will need to open the bleed valves on the radiators starting upstairs. Initially, I would slowly open one bleed valve, then all remaining bleed valves upstairs. Once the water exiting the pipe slows right down, you can then open the downstairs bleed valves. This should enable more water to exit the system. If you are lucky, you might have a drain off valve under the floor, which is great, as this will be the lowest point of the system. The aim of draining down is to get either as much water as you can out of the system, or you might only need to partially remove some water if, for example, you are working on upstairs radiators. As you can see here, we have lifted up the floor and have found some central heating pipes. Basically, this is known as a rat's nest. What you don't want to do with something like this is disturb anything, or you could be fixing or repairing pipes for fun. As you can see, there is no drain off valve below the floor, which is unfortunate. There is a gate valve which has been leaking, so we're going to use that to drain down fully. I've placed a rubble sack under the gate valve, which is a tip given to me by Razor. Josh is now undoing the centre of the gate valve, and I've got the wet and dry vacuum ready to suck up the remaining water. The vacuum is outside and I'm using an Omni-Ice dust separator and tub to collect the water. These are great as it is really easy to collect the water quickly. The reason why we are draining down this system is to cut out some old gate valves which have been leaking over the years. These were used when the heating system was a conventional system, but it was swapped over to a condensing combi boiler about 7 years ago. This will be covered in another video. We are now removing the magnetic filter and giving it a clean. It's a good idea to do this each time we empty the system. If you don't have one of these on your system, I would highly recommend getting one fitted, as they can prevent the boiler's heat exchanger getting blocked. So that's how to drain down a central heating system. Once you have completed the work on the system, it will need filling back up. To do that, you need to close the drain valve off, then go around and close all the bleed valves on all radiators. Normally, if I had done work on the system, I will fill the system just with water and check for leaks before draining down the system again and adding inhibitor to the system. If you prefer, you can fill the system, check for leaks, and then empty out some water so that you can add the inhibitor. If you have done any soldering at all on the system, you should flush out the whole system to remove any flux, residue, etc. For a combi boiler to refill the system, you need to use the filling loop, which is located close to the boiler. Here we need to open these two grey handled valves. This will put water at mains pressure into the system. Ideally, you need two people to do this, as it is much quicker. The other person can go to each downstairs radiator and open the bleed valve until the water exits. He can then do the upstairs radiators, whilst the other person controls the water pressure via the filling loop. Unfortunately, this boiler has a digital readout for the pressure, so the boiler needs to be switched back on so that the system can be filled to the correct pressure. For this boiler, it is about 1 bar. For a conventional system, you can just open the isolated valve or remove the isolation from the ball float valve. This will fill the header tank, which in turn will fill the system once it is bled. To add inhibitor to a conventional system, you can just pour it into the header tank when the system is filling. Conventional systems can be a real pain, especially if they are piped up in 10mm pipe. Because we have worked on the pipework and because the existing water was black in colour, we are going to empty the system again. Then we are going to fill it up with water, but we are also going to add two bottles of a fast-acting cleaner. A single bottle can be used for smaller central heating systems. To add the cleaner, I've removed the bleed valve from an upstairs radiator and emptied in two bottles using a funnel. Now the central heating will be filled to 1 bar of pressure. Then the central heating will be switched on for 1 hour. After an hour, the whole content of the central heating system will be emptied out again. You can see that the water is now running clear. This looks much different to when the original water was emptied out. We can now close the drain off valves and remove the hose pipe. I'm now filling the towel radiator with two bottles of inhibitor. This will mix with the circulating water and will prevent corrosion and limescale. Now we can refill the whole system as we did before by using the filling loop and at the same time bleeding every radiator on the system. Once all radiators have been bled, the central heating can be switched back on. Hopefully this will be the last time the central heating needs looking at for a few years.